Hello everyone, I hope you are doing well. First things first, next week's video will be the monthly Q&A. So please post your questions either in the comments section or in the Ask Dao Yi channel on the Dao Yi Discord, or email me if you prefer to remain anonymous. I remember very well that around the same time last year, in one of my videos, I mentioned that in the winter time, we still should practice martial arts in order to sweat, since sweating can detoxify our body. Also, in my personal experience over the decades, maintaining a regular routine of a physical exercise can elevate our mood, especially during the winter. I hope you still follow this advice. However, I would like to point out more based on that advice. It is also a good idea to consume some tonic products such as ginseng tea and so on, which can be used to strengthen our yang energy during the cold weather. Right now, most ginseng available in the market is cultivated. Cultivated ginseng is not as strong as wild ginseng. However, consuming a larger quantity of cultivated ginseng, for example, double the regular dosage, will provide an ideal benefit. Cultivated ginseng is a lot cheaper than wild ginseng, so it shouldn't make a huge difference to your finances. In the last few weeks since the announcement of the Dao Yi non-profit organization, many people asked me about how to study with me by becoming a Dao Yi member. I would like to take this opportunity to clarify this misunderstanding. Dao Yi is currently not focused on teaching. I will be launching my own online teaching program in the near future, which will be separate from and independent of Dao Yi. The objective of Dao Yi are to provide a platform for martial artists, Xiu Dao practitioner, Chinese medicine practitioner to share information, organize activities, promote different teachers and styles, among others. I will not use Dao Yi to promote myself. I may voluntarily contribute some training materials similar to what I'm doing on YouTube, but not for my personal teaching purposes. Of course, I will answer questions asked in the Ask Dao Yi channel in my Q&A videos, but other teachers are also welcome to answer questions there. It's not meant exclusively for me or my channel. With regard to my online teaching program, some of my friends have already recommended that I work on online teaching instead of publishing so much free material. Well, I understand and appreciate their recommendations. The COVID situation and a bunch of resulting issues have caused me to defer work on it. So for now, I'm still focusing on providing free materials to the community. Please be patient. I will get things sorted out and soon I will be able to go full throttle on the online teaching program. We already have recommendations about authors that could contribute serious and insightful content. Today, I have another request for suggestions related to the Dao Yi magazine. We would like your suggestions on light-hearted or entertaining content that you would like to see in the magazine. Anything ranging from humor to puzzles to contests. So I look forward to your suggestions either in the comments or on the Discord server or via email. That's about in terms of today's Dao Yi announcements. Now, let's move on to today's main topic. You may have heard the Chinese term 神似 or likeness in spirit. 神似 is an aspect of a methodology of a practice. As I have mentioned in the past, systematic introduction of the historical, philosophical, and cultural background of any concept is a very effective and comprehensive process. It requires research, knowledge, understanding, and synchronization in order to present such a video. Such topics are often not easy to understand, but I guarantee you that with time, you will understand those topics better. Also, the comprehensive organized content is my contribution to the community, which was so far largely unknown not only in the rest of the world, but also in China. So, topics covered in today's video include, first, 形 and 神, second, 形似 and 神似, third, how to practice and achieve 神似, fourth, martial 神似, fifth, misperception of 神似, sixth, common principles of martial 神似, seventh, demonstration, and eighth, takeaways. So, without any further ado, let's get started. Topic 1, 形 and 神. 形 means body or form, and 神 means mind or spirit. One of the most important long-standing topics in Chinese philosophy has been 形神论, or theory of body and spirit, which is the discussion of the relationships between 形 and 神, or body and spirit. Throughout Chinese history, different schools of philosophy have provided different explanations for 形神论. For example, 荀子 or 荀况, a Confucian philosopher and writer who lived approximately from 310 to 235 BCE, said, 形具而神生, or human body is the creation of nature, and human mind is created by human body. Psychological activities are based on the physical body. On the contrary, Hui Yuan, a famous Buddhist monk who lived during 334 to 416 CE, believed that 形尽神不灭, or spirit will not go extinct, even though the body could end or get destroyed. The concept of imperishable spirit is the core idea of the latter belief. We can see that, by nature, philosophers do not agree with each other, which makes the study of philosophy so interesting. So, 形神论has been a popular and widely disputed topic in Chinese philosophy for thousands of years. The 形神论, or theory of 形 and 神, or theory of mind and spirit, has evolved in terms of application in different fields beyond philosophy. So, what are 形似 and 神似? That brings us to the next topic. Topic 2, 形似 and 神似. Before discussing this topic, I'd like to remind you that I have a prior video titled Internal Style Concept 28, 气韵生动, in which I introduced the concept of 气韵, the classic Chinese aesthetic standard. Let me first replay that part of the video. 气韵, or energy and its resonance, are formless and intangible. However, this formlessness and intangibility are based on form and tangibility. The experience of the subject, resonance is based on the object, qi or energy. Qi yun is the inner experience of the audience, which can only be improved through personal cultivation, which transcends the physical aspect of the art itself. So, I recommend you watch the full video if you haven't already. The link is in the description. Now, let's talk about another similar term today, which is 神似. The term 神似 consists of two characters. 神 means spirit, 似 means alike. Put together, it means a likeness in spirit. 神似 is commonly used to describe the similarity between subject and object in spirit. The word spirit used here is an expression describing the nature of the similarity, not based on its physical aspect, but in an intangible way. By the way, 神似 was originally used in ancient Chinese art theory or aesthetics. And with time, the usage of 神似 has extended beyond art theory. The discussion of 神似 would be incomplete without the introduction of its counterpart, 形似. 形似 consists of two characters. 形 means form or appearance, and 似 means similar or alike. Put together, 形似 means a likeness in appearance. In appreciation of art, 形似 is used to describe a lower level of similarity. If someone says an artwork is 形似 to another subject, it is not the best compliment compared to use the first term 神似. By the way, 形似 even though is not that great, but very often it is not bad at all compared to another term 不似 or not alike. So, 形似 is the external or extrinsic similarity, while 神似 is the internal or intrinsic similarity between two subjects. One lies in the form and the appearance, while the other one lies in nature and the spirit. 形似 is the foundation of 神似. Without 形似, 神似 cannot exist.Without 神似, 形似 will only stay at a primitive level. The ideal stage, which in my opinion is 形神兼备, which will be introduced in a later section. Topic 3. How to practice and achieve 神似. According to ancient Chinese aesthetics, 神似 is based on 形似. In other words,形似 is the prerequisite for 神似. 神似 is the refined level of 形似. In other words, you have to focus on the 形似 first, then naturally progress to 神似. Otherwise, what you will end up with would just be a distortion, not 神似. Also, please keep in mind that achieving 神似 is not only an objective,But more importantly, it is also a process. It requires certain principles, which I will discuss later in this video. So, how to apply and practice 神似 in martial art practice, especially in the internal styles? How to distinguish and manage the relationship between 形似 and 神似? That brings us to the next topic. Topic 4.Martial 神似. Introducing the philosophical and aesthetic background of a term used in martial art practice is for better understanding the evolution of a term, and hopefully it can give a better idea of it. Any martial art practice begins with the student physically imitating the teacher. Usually,It takes years for someone to master the physical part before achieving 神似. Based on personal experience, most people require at least about 10 years of diligent practice to achieve complete 神思. Again, without first achieving 形思, there's no way to achieve 神思. In this video, I'd like to emphasize 神思 instead of 形思. So, let's dive deeper into it. So, what is 神思 in martial art practice? Well, actually, in martial art practice, 神思 can be a neutral term. Because 神思 is a term used to describe the similarity between a subject and an object. In this case, a teacher and a student. If the teacher reaches an advanced level, then the 神思 level of the student will naturally reach an advanced level. On the contrary, if the teacher has only remained at a low level to begin with, then even if the student has reached the 神思 level the teacher represents, the student's practice will still remain at a low level in martial standard. Unless, of course, the students can figure out the issue in their own practice and progress beyond their current limitations in knowledge. In other words, sources of information and practice play a key role in this situation. This is why, throughout history, many great martial artists were constantly looking for different practices from different qualified teachers to improve their own practice. Martial art practice is a journey, not a destination. Now, let's assume that a student is learning from a skilled and qualified teacher. This is what I'd like to talk about in today's video. First and foremost, students have to precisely copy the movements of the teacher without trying to modify the practice. I have to say, if a student tries to be adaptive in the learning process, then 神思 will never happen because the 形思 process itself has been distorted to begin with. At the same time, in my opinion, real 神思 is achieved from the understanding of a martial application in the teaching process. So, being able and willing to explain the martial application of each movement is key to helping students achieve 神思. Achieving complete 神思 requires many years of practice. However, partial 神思 can be quickly achieved by learning martial application from a student's perspective. This is why learning and teaching is an interactive process that, when managed well, accelerates the progression of a student. Also, very often, a student may have a different body shape and learning habits compared to the teacher. Being able to explain the key concept and the purpose of each posture and movements can help the students to reach the 神思 level faster. So, going beyond the physical differences and the learning habits is an important aspect of teaching skills, which should be built upon mutual understanding between both parties. In order to help your better understanding 神思, I have created a 5-step method which will be introduced in topic 6 of this video. To summarize, martial application is the spirit of any martial art style, and understanding applications can really help students achieve 神思. However, it should be built upon the mastery of 形思. So, is 神思 so well understood by the community that there are no misperceptions of it? Well, not in the slightest. That brings us to the next topic. Topic 5. Misperceptions of 神思. There are quite a few misperceptions about the 神思 concept in martial art practice. Since shensi is not a very popular term, as a result, many practitioners are unaware of the existence of a shensi in martial art practice. In other words, many practitioners have never paid attention to the methodological aspect of this issue. First, all of the form practiced should be the same no matter which school. For example, in Xingyi practice, there exist different branches in Xingyi. Consider Santi posture as an example. There have been so many different ways to keep the posture throughout Xingyi history. Even though they all follow the same principle, the external demonstrations are very often different. Especially to beginners, they will look very different. Actually, internally, they all follow the same principle. Being able to identify the inner spirit is more important than identifying the differences in external form. So, an advanced practitioner can observe and appreciate the inner energy in addition to the obvious external physical structure. Of course, it requires experience, knowledge, training, and expertise. Observing the internal energy through external structure is similar to being able to distinguish a real diamond from a diamond-shaped glass object. When I teach my students Santi posture, I always adjust their posture according to their body features as well as the branch of Xingyi I'm teaching at that point in time. Because in Hebei-style Xingyi, different branches apply different physical structures for the Santi posture. I will introduce it in the future. Second, since shensi is an advanced level and involves freedom of martial expression, practitioners can freely create their own shensi. This is another common misperception. Yes, shensi does involve freedom of martial expression, but it should be built upon the solid foundation of xingsi. Without the right xingsi, the so-called shensi is just sloppy practice. Actually, I firmly believe it is irresponsible of a teacher to encourage students to focus on shensi in the early stage of practice. A student must first achieve xingsi and then naturally progress to shensi. I have only pointed out two very common misperceptions. Of course, there are many more. Let's move on to the next topic so that I can introduce some important practice principles of shensi. Topic 6. Common principles of martial shensi. As I mentioned earlier in this video, I have created a 5-step method as the general principles to teach shensi in the internal martial art practice. I created 4 of them myself. Well, I borrowed the last one from an old Chinese poem. The 5-step method includes the following. First, 以形立基, focus on form practice as a foundation. Second, 形形相应, forms from both parties should be a reflection of each other. Third, 舍形存神, de-emphasize the form but keep the spirit. 4. 以神代行, apply the spirit to improve form. 5. 神形兼备, both form and spirit coexist. Now, let me explain each of them. First, 以形立基, 以 means use, 形 means form, 立 means create, 基 means foundation. Put together, it means to focus on form practice in order to build a foundation. As I have mentioned previously, in any martial art practice, you need to copy and repeat formal practice with the help of your teacher in order to get the 形式 level. It is the first step in any practice. I have to say that if you cannot even practice as per your teacher's requirement, there is no way to reach the higher level. Second, 形形相应. 形 means form, 相 means mutually, 应 means reflect. Put together, it means that forms from both parties should be a reflection of each other. So, the first form means the student's practice, and the second form means the teacher's practice. Student's practice should reflect the teacher's teaching. This step is built upon the previous one because I let you observe 以形立基, there's no way to achieve 形形相应. 3. 舍形存神. 舍 means de-emphasize. 形 means form. 存 means remain or keep. 神 means spirit. Put together, it means that to de-emphasize the form but keep the spirit. It is the higher level approach that after mastery of the form or achieving 形式, students should focus on the 神似 instead of remaining at 形式. Also, as I mentioned that martial application is the nature and essence of any martial practice, so focusing on the application of each movement is the key to achieving 神似. Fourth, 以神代行. 以 means use, 神 means spirit, 代 means lead, 神 means form. Put together, it means use the spirit to lead the form. In other words, apply the spirit to improve your form. This is a further advanced level. Practitioners can improve their 形式 or form by applying skills gained through 神似 or likeness in spirit. At this stage, it is the spirit that improves the form. Fifth, 形神兼备. 形 means form, 神 means spirit. 兼 means both, 备 means exist. Put together, it means both form and spirit coexist. This is the highest level of 形式 practice so far. So, the practitioner achieves a high level in form and spirit alike. This is an ideal stage of practice. Of course, there is an even higher level which I call 形神俱妙, going beyond 形 and 神, which is beyond the scope of today's video, and I will talk about it in the future. Seventh, demonstration. Today, I'd like to demonstrate three types of 崩拳 from three different branches of Hebei-style 形意, Li Chunyi, Zhang Zhaodong, and Xue Dian branches. You will see that their movements have some subtle differences in form, but are the same in martial spirit. This is what Li Chunyi's branch, Beng Quan, look like. So it's more downward. So extend, then. For Zhang Zhaodong's Beng Quan, it's more extend to the sideway and a little bit downward. So. Now, let me demonstrate the Xue Dian branch Beng Quan look like. They go forward, downward, then slightly up in the end. So, they are different in form, but share the similarity in spirit. Topic 8, takeaways. First, the relationship between 形 and 神, or theory of 形 and 神, has been a very important, long-standing topic of discussion in Chinese philosophy. Xing means body or form, and Shen means spirit. Second, Xing Si is the likeness in form, but subject and object, while Shen Si is the likeness in spirit between them. Third, in martial art practice, a student is said to have achieved Xing Si if their form practice resembles their teacher's. Likewise, a student is said to have achieved Shen Si if their practice also captures the spirit of the movement. This can be achieved by understanding and practicing the applications of a movement along with diligent practice over many years. 4. Two misperceptions of Shen Si. First, all of the form practice should be the same no matter which school. Second, since Shen Si is an advanced level and involves freedom of martial expression, practitioners can freely create their own Shen Si. Fifth, five steps method as five common principles of Shen Si include, first, 以形立基, or focus on formal practice as a foundation. Second, 形形相应, or forms from both parties should be a reflection of each other. Third, 舍形纯神, or de-emphasize the form but keep the spirit. Fourth, 以神代形, or apply the spirit to improve form. And fifth, or 形神兼备, or both form and spirit coexist. Do not forget to check out the demonstration section to get an idea of outwardly different but martially similar versions of Beng Quan practice in the three different branches of Hebei Xing Yi. That brings us to the end of today's video. Quick reminder to send me your questions of a next week's Q&A video. Thanks for watching, see you next time, and enjoy your practice.